Good morning, students. Welcome to Measure Integration live lectures. In this lecture, we'll discuss about integral of Lebesgue integral of non-negative measurable functions. Okay. So, if we recall what we defined so far, Lebesgue integral. So, we are defining Lebesgue integral step by step. So, first one we have defined if your f is some characteristic function. Okay. Then, obviously, what is Lebesgue integration? Is nothing but measure of that set. Okay. Then, if A is measurable, of course. Okay. Then, second step is, of course, for simple functions. So, simple functions, that means if you say f is equal to summation ai chi of ai is the representation, then how Lebesgue integration is defined? How this integration is defined? Summation ai measure of ai. Whether you remember or not? For a simple function, how Lebesgue measure integration is defined? If f is summation ai chi of ai, then integration of f is equal to summation ai measure of ai. Yes or no?
Yes, sir.
Okay.
Yes, sir.
Then next step, what we define is if f is bounded, okay, measurable function, then how integration of f is defined? This is
supremum.
Infimum, and of course also supremum. Infimum of psi, where psi is a simple function such that psi greater than or equal to f, they are all simple. That means this we have defined in terms of simple functions integration, right? This is similarly same as supremum of integration of phi less than or equal to f. Is this clear? Right? And we have seen several properties, and in last class we also proved for this bounded measurable functions what is meant by Lebesgue bounded convergence theorem, right? Yes or no? Last class we have proved that one. Now in this class we will define Lebesgue integral for a non-negative measurable function. So we will define Lebesgue integration for f greater than or equal to 0. Okay. For that we will define simple few basic definitions. So we say that if f is measurable, then support of f is nothing but the x, all x such that f of x is non-zero. Okay, so this set is said to be support of f, where f of x is not equal to 0, then collect such x, right? Now in last few classes we have seen what is meant by a function, a measurable function f vanishes outside a set of finite measure. What is meaning of saying that? If there exists a measurable set E naught, subset of E, okay, with measure of E naught is finite, okay, and this F vanishes outside this set means what? And F is equal to 0 on E minus E naught. Right? Yes or no? E minus E naught. Okay. So this we have used several times when we have defined integration of bounded measurable functions. Right? So if you see this one, and using this, what is meant by saying that something is of finite support? So we say that F is of finite support if this measure of this set, measure of this x such that f of x not equal to 0 is finite. Okay. Now, if you combine these two, what we'll get is that f is of finite support is same as saying that this f vanishes outside a set of finite measure. Is that clear? Why? This, instead of saying vanishes outside a set of finite measure, you can say that this measurable function of finite support. Why? If f is of finite support, see f, suppose f is of finite support, right? That means what? That means measure of this set x such that f of x is not equal to 0 is finite, right? Then by taking this, so now take your e naught as x such that f of x is not equal to 0, right? Is this clear? Then obviously your measure of e naught is finite. Yes or no? Now what about outside e naught? What is the value of f of x? And f equal to 0 on e minus e naught. Is this clear? Because what is your e naught? It is all x such that f of x is not equal to 0. So what is meant by saying outside e naught? Outside e naught, f value is 0. Is this clear?
Yes.
Is this step clear or not? Because e naught is all points x such that f of x is not equal to 0. So if something is not there in e naught, that means f of x value is 0. Is this clear? So therefore, if you see this one, we got a set e naught whose measure is finite and f is equal to 0 on e minus e naught. This is same as saying that f vanishes outside a set of finite measure. Okay. Is this clear? Yes or no? So if f vanishes outside a set of finite measure, then we can also define integration of f over e even if m of e is infinite. Okay. That means another remark what we are going to discuss is that suppose f is, so either you write vanishes outside a set of finite measure or f is of finite support. Suppose f is of finite support, then integration of f over e is, okay, f is say defined even if measure of e is infinite. Okay, it is not necessary that measure of e is finite. Why? Because since the reason is integration of, because it is a finite support, so there exists e naught, okay, with measure of e naught is zero, finite, and your f is zero on e minus e naught. Therefore, integration of f over e, integration of, so here you write f is bounded and of finite support. Okay. Then integration of f over e is nothing but, you can write this as integration of f e in e naught union with e minus e naught. But this is same as by yesterday property, it is this. Okay, now f is 0 on e minus e naught, therefore this value is 0. Yes or no? So therefore this is same as integration of f over e naught. What we know about e naught? E naught is a finite measure, right? So no matter, even if measure of e is infinite, this value is still defined, provided if it is of finite support. Is this clear? Yes or no? Okay, so no matter, now onwards we just say that e is measurable. It is not necessary that measure of e is finite is not required. Okay, fine. Now we'll define definition. Let f be a non-negative measurable function. So last time we have taken f a bounded measurable function. So now we are taking f a non-negative measurable function. It is not necessary that it is bounded. Okay, then Lebesgue integral of f is defined as f over measurable set. Okay, f over E, where E is measurable, okay, is defined as integral of f over E is equal to, that's like similar to here what we have defined. Okay, yes or no? That for a bounded function we have taken the help of simple functions. Now for a non-negative functions we will take the help of bounded functions. Is this clear? So what should be your definition? Yes, this should be integral of h, okay, where h is a bounded measurable function with finite support. Okay, then this is over E, but now we have to take here supremum or infimum. We will check here supremum such that your h is less than or equal to f. Okay, so can we define, this is the definition of Lebesgue integral of a non-negative measurable function. Is definition clear? Integral of f over E is defined as integral of h, so where h is a bounded measurable function, okay, with a finite support. What is meaning of saying that finite support? That is measure of x such that h of x is not equal to 0. This is should be finite. Is this clear? Now can we define this infimum of like this, how we have defined for bounded functions? Can we define this as infimum? So let me write as a remark. Few remarks we will discuss about this Lebesgue integral of non-negative one. So if at all we want to define infimum of this, say suppose some k where f, that means this k is greater than or equal to f, can we define like this is the question. Just like for a bounded function, for bounded functions we have taken this as well as for this. So shall we, similar way, can we take or can we define for non-negative measurable function? That is the question. Can we take it or is there any problem? Tell me. What we know about f? F is known to be non-negative. Whether it is bounded, we don't know whether it is bounded or not. Is this clear? But if we take like this,
yes,
k greater than or equal to f, okay, that means this f is, and k is a bounded function, right? That means f, you will get bounded, right? But we don't know whether f is a bounded function or not. Therefore, this definition we cannot take. Is this clear? Yes or no? So this,
yes,
makes sense only if this makes sense only for functions which are bounded. Okay, so if it is not bounded function, then this is, it is not having proper. Okay, if your f is not bounded, then you cannot define in this way. Are you following? But whereas you can define for all bounded functions h less than or equal to f, then take supremum. Okay, yes or no? So that is your first remark, that infimum of k may not defined as f need not be bounded, right? So this cannot be the proper, you cannot define like this. Okay, any problem? Now, because if f is greater than or equal to 0, then this integration of f over e is also greater than or equal to 0, because this f is non-negative. Your f is non-negative. So if you want, you can add here this also. We don't require a non-negative bounded functions because your f is greater than or equal to 0. So we will approximate by non-negative bounded functions only. Okay. Right. So if f is, because f is greater than or equal to 0, therefore integration of f is also greater than or equal to 0. But this may be infinite also. Earlier it was not the case, but this may be infinite also. Okay, so only you can check that integration of f over e is greater than or equal to 0 as your f is greater than or equal to 0. Right? Yes or no? Okay. Now we'll see some properties just like how we have seen in last class. So as a, you can call it theorem, that let f and g be non-negative measurable functions defined on E. Okay. Then the first one is integration of, if you take any scalar, C times f over E is C times integration of f over E, where C should be greater than 0. Why? If C is less than 0, then C of is not negative. Okay. So we are defining integration only for non-negative measurable functions. Right? Is this clear? Then the second one, yes, is linear property, that integration of f plus g over e is same as integration of f over e plus integration of g over e. Okay. So linear, this is linear property. The third one is monotone. That means if f is say less than or equal to g almost everywhere, then integration of f over e is less than or equal to integration of g over e. Okay. So proof of this theorem, first one and third one are similar to what we have proved for bounded functions. Only one, the second one, half is similar, the remaining half is only different. Okay. So I'll leave it first one to prove yourself. Okay. One is, do it as exercise. That means what you want to do? What is the hint? It is similar to the previous one. Definition, you have to take supremum. Right? Integration of C times F over E. How it is defined? How we have defined integration of non-negative measurable function? This is nothing but supremum of integration of all H, where H is a bounded function. Just now we have defined integration of H, where H is less than or equal to F. So here your F is C. Is this clear? C times F. Now simplify this, yes, and bring it to H less than or equal to F form. Is that clear? That we have did as it is, same way what we did in for bounded case. Okay. Now we'll see second one. Is this first one, is there any difficulty to complete the proof? If you have really understood, yes, the case for bounded case, bounded measurable function, it is as it is, nothing. You are taking supremum. Okay. Now second one, the half part is similar to bounded functions. That means let H, okay, H be a bounded measurable function with finite support. So you can call it let H and K, okay, be bounded measurable functions with finite support such that your H is less than or equal to F and K is less than or equal to G. So we have taken bounded measurable functions with finite support, H less than or equal to F and K less than or equal to G. This implies, because H and K are bounded, what you will get? H plus k is also bounded less than or equal to f plus g, right? And is also of finite support or not? And is of finite support. Why? What is the reason? Since x such that h of x plus k of x is not equal to 0, this measure of this set is finite. Okay? Yes or no? Guess measure of x such that h of x is not equal to 0 is finite. X such that k of x is not equal to 0 is also finite. So therefore, this one is less than or equal to measure of h of x plus measure of that k of x, which is finite. Is this clear? So therefore, what can you talk about this one? What can you say about? This implies, if you take the integration of h plus k, okay, is less than or equal to integration of this f plus g, right? Yes or no? Yes or no?
Yes, sir.
Are you following? Because our integration of f plus g is defined as supremum of that. That means it is least upper bound or not. So this f is, integration of f is always bigger than or equal to integration of every such h. So our h is h plus k. Okay. But this implies integration of h, we can apply now linear property for h and k, because h and k are bounded functions, is less than or equal to integration of f plus g. Is this clear? So therefore, this is true for all h less than or equal to f and for all k less than or equal to g, right? Hence, by taking supremum, also this is true. So supremum of integration of h over e plus supremum, this one is also less than or equal to f plus g over e, right? But what is supremum of h over e, where h is less than or equal to f and k less than or equal to g? This is nothing but integration of f over e plus integration of g over e is less than or equal to integration of f plus g over e. Okay. So this part is similar to what we did in bounded case. But in for bounded case, the other way is also simple like this. But here it is not the case, because this integration is not defined in terms of infimum. Okay. So we have to do it in little bit different way. Is this clear? Any problem? So what we do is, to prove the other way, let you take the function L. Let L be a bounded measurable function with finite support, such that this L is less than or equal to f plus g, because we want to find integration of f plus g over e. So you take all bounded measurable functions with finite support less than or equal to that one, right? Okay. Then based on this L and based on our f and g, we will define new functions. So we will get some function h, which is bounded and finite support such that h is less than or equal to f. So the idea is, so what we'll do is, the idea is that we'll get functions h such that h is less than or equal to f and k less than or equal to g, right? Then use the fact they are bounded measurable functions. So you get relation among integration of h. Then what you get here is this, okay? Integration of f and integration of k is less than or equal to integration of g, right? And then try to relate with L again. That is the idea. So for that, define say h of x. So define h of x as minimum of f of x comma this L of x. This L is, we have taken, let L be a bounded measurable function. So define h of x as minimum of f of x and L of x, and the other function k of x as this h of x minus l of x. Okay, h of x, what is it? L of x minus h of x. Okay, then we'll see that this h and k are finite bounded bounded measurable functions with finite support, such that h is less than or equal to f and k is less than or equal to g. Clearly, h is less than or equal to f is clear from this definition, right? Clearly, h of x is less than or equal to f of x, because h of x is minimum of these two values. Okay, now we'll show that k of x is less than or equal to g of x. Okay, and this their h of x, h and k are of finite support. Okay, so how we, so we use the fact that L is a measurable function with finite support, right? So let call it some set E naught is equal to x, such that L of x is not equal to 0. Okay, then because our L is a finite support, so therefore L of E naught is finite. Measure of E naught. Therefore, measure of E naught is finite. So on this one, we'll see whether x says that h of x not equal to 0. So if you take x outside E naught, so x and h is equal to 0 on E minus E naught. Are you with me? Because L of x is not equal to 0 on E naught, so outside E naught it is 0. So if L is equal to 0, then what can you say about h of x? This implies h of x is equal to, because it is minimum of f of x comma L of x, so h of x is equal to 0 on E minus E naught. Is this clear? Yes or no? Can somebody tell why h of x is equal to 0 on E minus E naught? Because h of x is minimum of f of x and L of x. Since our f of x is actually greater than or equal to 0, but our h of x is, this L of x is 0, right? L of x is 0 on E minus E naught. So therefore, f of x is now bigger than L of x on E minus E naught, right? So therefore, h of x is minimum of these two, which is L of x. Therefore, it is also equal to 0, right? Also, what can you say about k of x? Because L is 0 on E minus E naught, h is also 0 on E minus E naught. So therefore, this difference is also 0 on E minus E naught. Clear? Any problem? H of x is equal to 0, k of x is equal to 0 on E minus E naught, right? Any problem? So this h and k vanishes outside a set with of a finite measure. So we can talk about integration of h over that set E. Is this clear? So we can talk about integration of h over E as well as integration of k over E, right? Now we'll show that this k of x is less than or equal to g of x. So because h of x is minimum of this, it may be equal to f of x or it may be equal to L of x. So now if h of x say equal to f of x, then what can you say about k of x? Then k of x is equal to L of x minus h of x, but our h of x is f of x, right? L of x minus h of x, which is same as f of x. But now you can check that L minus f is less than or equal to g or not. From here, L is less than or equal to f plus g. This implies L minus f is less than or equal to g of x. Is this clear? So if your h of x is f of x, then k of x is less than or equal to g of x. Now, if your h of x, it is minimum of f of x and l of x. So, if your h of x is equal to l of x, then what is k of x? K of x is l of x minus h of x. So, if they are equal, then obviously k of x is 0. And we know that this is less than or equal to g of x because our f and g are non-negative functions. Yes or no? So, in any case,
yes, sir,
what we have proved is that k of x is less than or equal to g of x. Right? Any problem?
No, sir.
So, therefore, h and k. Right? Therefore, h and k are this h of x is minimum of l of x and f of x and l of x, but l is given to be bounded. Is this clear? Because l is given to be bounded, so therefore h is also bounded, and k is l as well as h, which is difference of bounded functions, therefore they are also bounded. Hence, therefore h and k are bounded measurable functions, okay, with finite support, or they vanish, you can write it, okay, such that your h of x is less than or equal to f of x and k of x is less than or equal to g of x, right? So therefore, by the definition of integration of f over e, because it is supremum, what you will get is integration of h over e, and similarly integration of k over e is less than or equal to integration of g. Remember, they are vanishing on e naught, okay, over e. Is this clear? Right? This implies integration of h over e plus integration of k over e is less than or equal to integration of e
integration of
this one. Is this clear? Any problem? But now, because this h and k are bounded measurable functions, we know for linearity this is true. That means it is same as h plus k over e less than or equal to integration of f over e plus integration of g over e. Is this clear? Any problem? Therefore, integration of this g minus f or f minus g, whatever, no problem. Okay, or integration of e is equal to integration of g minus f. This I will write as e naught union e minus e naught. These two are disjoint sets, but this is again same as integration of g minus f over e naught plus integration of g minus f over e minus e naught. But measure of e naught is 0. Okay. Measure of e naught is 0. So therefore, this value is 0. What you will get here is integration of g minus f e minus e naught. Okay. But this is greater than or equal to, because g minus f on e naught, e minus e naught, this g minus f is greater than or equal to 0. So therefore, this is greater than or equal to 0. Since g minus f is greater than or equal to 0 on e minus e naught. Okay. So therefore this, but this is same as, therefore 0 less than or equal to integration of g minus f over e, which is same as integration of g minus f over e minus e naught. Right. Now, I can apply linear property. This is same as integration of g over e minus e naught minus integration of f over e minus e naught. Okay. But this is again same as integration of g over e, because on e naught, this integration is 0. Right. And integration of f over e naught. This implies you are getting here integration of g over e, right, minus integration of f over e naught is greater than or equal to 0. Right. So if you bring this f here, integration of f over e naught is less than or equal to, right, integration of g over e naught. that is same as integration of f over e is less than or equal to integration of g over e. Okay, because remember measure of e naught is zero, right? Any problem? Any problem?
Sir.
That if monotonicity, if f is less than or equal to g almost everywhere, then we don't know whether g minus f is greater than or equal to 0 or not. So where g minus f is greater than or equal to 0 and the set e minus e naught. So we will see that integration of this is same as integration of this. Now applying linear property, we get this. Okay. That proves this properties of this Lebesgue integral of non-negative measurable functions. Okay. In next class, we'll see some interesting results about when we can take integration and limit inside. Okay. So in next class, we'll see some results, something called Fatou's lemma. Okay. And monotone convergence theorem, which talks about Lebesgue integration of non-negative measurable functions. Is that clear? We'll stop here, and in next class we'll see these results.